Can we rotate out of here for lunch?
Sure, yeah, you can, you should be. Because cafeteria closes in about 45 minutes, so.
Thank you.
We'll probably need to go get something to eat. Okay, all right. You're the one who kept talking.
You're the one who was.
Oh, by the way.
All right.
This one's a little, you got to hear from basically the same people.
I have no phone, just a deal.
No, I'm just letting you know.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
Don't.
Yeah, okay. All righty, let's, I'll kind of, since he's the sponsor of the next bill, I'll just go ahead and keep going until he comes back, how's that sound, all right?
Excellent. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I'm a hard-headed pain in the butt.
I like that.
Cheyenne Harding.
All right.
That'll teach you to smile. Welcome back.
Thanks. I'm speaking on this bill because I've had personal experience with growing into the realization of what recording has done for me and hasn't done for me. When I was really young, I had an altercation with a teacher, so I kind of wish that Miss May Dupuy, I hope I said that right, would have been here for this part, but history teacher, new curriculum with a new type of process they introduced into our school where schooling was centralized so you could go forward based off of your own progress rate. And they introduced tablets to the school, and you had to sign off saying that yes, you'd be responsible to pay a $50 fee if something happened to it, even if someone else broke it. Well, I grew up in a very poor family, so $50 was out of the question, so I didn't sign off on it. And I was probably the only kid at the end of the senior high school year still without a tablet. And this made it extremely difficult for my teachers to regulate my specific type of schooling because all their programs were based off of the software that tablet could use. So they actually had to basically give me my own curriculum, all paper-based, where I couldn't do anything in the entire classroom, where all my work had to be at home just because I didn't have the tablet. The reason how this comes back to the recording is after I caused, I only had one issue with one teacher, my history teacher, Mr. Helmrich. My grades significantly decreased after this altercation, after he started to have to do more work to change my curriculum. And I went above and beyond what I had to do. I spent 5 hours on a project when all I had to do was basically tell the meaning of a song that was based off of the Vietnam War. And I did a whole video presentation, synced it up, wrote an essay on it, and I should have gotten at least a 90. My grade on that project was a 76. And my grades continued to be just barely above failing in that classroom, and I redouble-checked my work with all the facts online. I got papers back that were graded wrong. I brought it to the school superintendent. They finally got it fixed, but for 3 quarters, it wasn't fixed till 4th quarter, for 3 quarters I had failing grades because I couldn't prove that a teacher was discriminating against me because I had no way to record him or auditorily prove that, yes, over the phone he was nice with my parents, or to the superintendent of the school he was saying one thing, but in the classroom he was acting another way. So that's, it's not just public officials like police officers or cop officers. It's anybody who has any, basically even me, anyone should be able to be recorded to either protect what you know if you're using it defensively, or to prove that someone is intentionally harming you or your character or your being. Second experience is, even after that, I was 18 years old, I just got my brand new car, my cousin helped me with that. brand new car, it was kind of a hunk of junk, no interior, and, but, still nonetheless, just going through the day, riding around, and a police officer pulled us over. And my cousin had gotten into the habit, because of his offense, that to protect himself, he always wanted to record. And I was like, no, Joey, you don't have to record. I don't want him to think that we're, you know, intimidating him or making him feel like he's on the spot. I don't. So he finally acquiesced to me, and he didn't record the situation. And the police officers were not only rude, accused there of being drugs in the car. It was a brand new car. I'm never smoked, never done alcohol, nothing in my life. I never will. There was absolutely no way there was drugs in this car. There was zero interior, couldn't hide anything. The interior was orange rust, basically, but it just basically passed inspection. And he had us all get out of the car and basically wait for a cop to come search the car. And I felt like I was being illegally searched and seized. And I had no proof of it because I tried to give the benefit of the doubt. After that specific situation, I no longer fight my cousin to record. And we've had zero problems with officers once they're made aware of that they're on recording. And I've even seen an officer's attitude change once you say, oh, by the way, officer, you're on audio and video surveillance. I mean, I've watched an officer go from straight, disrespectful, rude, mean, and insultive towards my cousin to, you're all set, you're free to go. I'm sorry, I hope you have a nice day. I don't understand why. I can speculate that there's some issues with what my cousin has done, but no one deserves that, and you should always be able to feel like you're treated the same, especially as becoming rehabilitated back into this world. Thirdly, hopefully I can speak on your behalf.
You may.
All right. My cousin was diagnosed with petite mal seizures as a young kid, and he has ADHD. Severely. I've never met somebody that is so off track. But I love him. And because I love him, I try to help take care of him. I schedule his appointments and I do all that stuff. Little did I know that I scheduled an EEG for him to try to help diagnose his migraines and try to get all that squared away. I didn't know the date I scheduled was the same day he had to go to parole. You earlier heard about this. My fault. He wasn't intentionally going there with video and audio surveillance, but they wanted to monitor his facial expressions and his audio sounds during his sleep so they could tell if he was having seizures at night. It was my fault that he went there to parole with the EEG on his forehead, and he was cornered into a room, and he was ordered to remove surgical glue off his head that would have ripped his skin. I mean, we're talking about just trying to solve a medical issue, and they're literally verbally assaulting him and intimidating him. He had five officers corner him in a room no bigger than probably 5x8. Something completely not his fault. He couldn't prove, and they said the next time you come in here with an audio or video surveillance equipment, we're letting you. We're bringing you back to prison. You cannot video record beyond this door. Even though they audio and video record the very room that I sit in when he goes to parole, and they watch the public come in. But the second you go beyond their door, you can't record them. And we're not allowed in with him. That is scary. That is intimidating. And to speak on, against a lady that was previously here, I think her name was Mrs. Rice. I don't know her, but she said it's highly intimidating for her to speak in public or to be recorded. And I understand that. I'm autistic, I have social anxiety, it's completely hard for me to speak on anything public. My face turns red up here, I hate it. And the only reason why I speak here is because I'm passionate about these problems, and I believe they need to be solved, and I believe that this is the correct way to go about fixing our community in a healthy, suggestive way. So I am up here being recorded because it's something I believe in. Even with social anxiety, fear of speaking, and a very mild form of autism. So I don't think that that is an excuse to not be recorded. I think that if you're honest and you have nothing to hide, you should be able to be recorded, and you should always be able to record yourself to protect yourself. More often than not, we come into problems being, oh, no, I don't want to be recorded, and they hang up. And we can't prove that we even tried. It needs to be passed so that you could, you know, do what you need to do and defend yourself and not face scrutiny for it. And that's basically my testimony.
Thank you.
Any questions?
I see none. Thank you very much.
I would just ask people to be as brief as possible, because like I said, we are pretty much behind time, and I've got two more bills to hear this afternoon. So.
The sponsor might die of starvation, too.
Why don't you go grab a bite? And if we get to it before you do, we'll be more than happy to find somebody to introduce it. And
good to meet you. Bowie.
Garret, Ian?
Yep.
So, like many of the folks that have spoken here today, I too have been here countless times on similar issues and wonder why it is that it takes New Hampshire so long to adjust on something that I see as such a simple, basic freedom issue, the right to document what is around you. As Representative Robertson pointed out, our eyes are flawed, our minds are flawed. We're not going to be able to document and remember things the way a camera can. The amount of journalism that a camera is capable of achieving is far in excess of what I'm capable of doing with my mind. I'm not even going to try to recount the number of times I've had issues with police and authorities trying to stop me from recording, physically taking property from me. I've had police waiting outside my house to steal a camera from me. That case ended up getting dropped. And all of these things, this is the Criminal Justice and Public Safety Committee. Recording is not a threat to anyone's safety. The things that actually hurt people are the job of the Criminal Justice and Public Safety Committee. Recording is by definition a passive activity. Now, there was a lot of fear mongering from other public officials that spoke on this bill about, well, if people are allowed to record, if it's legal, as it should be, it's a human right, then somehow they'll be stalking people, they'll be in people's homes, they'll be doing all of these things that sound like crimes to me. It sounds like trespassing to be in someone's home without permission. It sounds like trespassing to be in someone's office without permission. So I don't see why there would automatically be recordings of all of these private spaces. If you want your space to be private, you don't bring journalists into them. So considering all of the concerns about this bill, if it needs to be simplified, please do make New Hampshire a one-party consent state, as it should be, as anybody should be able to have their right to record. We're all equals. There should not be classes of people that can record and can't. Under the current law, the police have special exemptions for how they can record us, the public, but of course they might act out if we record them. Please do change the law so that recording is recognized as a right and not a crime. And I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you. Any questions? Seeing none, thank you very much. David Crawford? Joseph Brooks.
Thank you.